Hello and welcome to Cal State Fullerton's The Report with the latest news, views, and info to go. I'm Christina Rasband.
I'm Sarah Fenton.
And I'm Jen Moynihan.
Today we will start by discussing some hot topics including celebrity iCloud photos leaked online, another retailer's credit card breach, and one city's controversial voter incentive, as well as the suspension of an NFL player.
Beyond our discussion, we have reports on current CSUF events, including Taco Tuesday, the Big History event, a concert under the stars, and ASI's annual block party.
And finally, we'll conclude with some key local and national news on the California governor's debate, a local plane's emergency landing, Apple's latest gadgets, the death of a beloved comedian, and so much more.
But first, we'll begin with our segment called Hot Topics, where we'll discuss the top trending topics of the week. Hundreds of nude female celebrity photos were leaked online earlier this month due to targeted attacks on their personal iCloud accounts. Actresses Jennifer Lawrence and Kristen Dunst and pop star Ariana Grande were among celebrities reportedly shown in the photos. In an interview with Wall Street Journal, Apple Chief Executive Officer Tim Cook said celebrity iCloud accounts were compromised because hackers obtained celebrity login information or guessed the answers to security questions. Cook denied the possibility that the incident was caused by Apple security breach. To prevent similar incidents from happening in the future, Apple says it will start sending alerts to users anytime account passwords are changed and when iCloud information is restored to a new device or when a device logs into an account for the first time. Ladies, what do you think about the celebrity hacks?
Well, I mean, as much as I love Jennifer Lawrence, what was she thinking? I mean, 200 photos uploaded to the iCloud, keep it off the iCloud, delete it off your phone.
Well, here's the thing, like on my phone, my pictures automatically get sent to the iCloud, and it's been that way ever since I bought my phone. So I don't really know how to like shut that off. So maybe that happened to her.
That's possible.
No. I'm just glad I never figured out how to work the cloud. I mean, I'll leave the cloud up in the sky, it can go away. I don't want anything to do with it because with everything that's going on, I just don't trust it right now. It's kind of scary for me, so we'll leave the cloud up in the sky.
Well, I mean, some people probably have that same perspective. You know, they think of the cloud as like an inanimate thing out there where, you know, they don't really know how to use it. They don't really know, you know, what to put on it. Mm-hmm. And then like, it doesn't help when people can hack into it and steal things, especially if you're a celebrity.
Nope. It's not good for you.
No,
not at all.
Leave the cloud in the sky. Home Depot confirmed Monday that the company experienced a breach in its payment system. The company announced that the incident could be tracked as far back as April, making all consumer credit card information used since that period vulnerable. As one of the largest retailers in the country with 2,248 locations in the U.S., Home Depot has around 60 million customers potentially affected by the attack. That's almost as many as the 70 million customers affected by Target's security breach last year. Ladies, what is your payment method of choice and what should companies do to protect their customers' account information?
Oh, I don't know about you guys, but I use my credit card basically for everything. I think the only time I use cash is when I go to the gas station. I don't know, for me it's easier. What about you?
The gas station.
Yeah.
Yeah, I try to use cash. Because that way I can like be like, oh, I have $40 in my wallet. Oh, I spent 10 today, I have 30 left. But it typically ends up being my credit card because it's just easier. I can just swipe it real fast and don't have to deal with the change.
Oh yeah, and then, I mean, it scares me carrying a lot of cash around. I mean, you don't know who's going to take it. I don't want to take that risk. I use my card for everything. So, I mean, with all this going on, it's kind of scary, but at the same time, you have the possibility of someone taking your purse with all your money in it too, so.
Mm-hmm. That's true, or getting your credit card information. I mean, maybe we should just do a Europe thing and have that encrypted card where when you use it, the number's different every time so nobody can steal it.
Yeah, I'm all for that.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, and with technology always advancing, I mean, there's not much that you can do right now. There's security that is already in place. And obviously there are people that have figured out how to breach that security. So mm-hmm. Now we just need to figure out how to step up and make it even safer.
So I'll switch over to Apple Pay, guys.
Apple Pay. Yep. Let's do it.
And an effort to encourage more citizens to vote in the city of Los Angeles is considering cash prizes as a new incentive. In August, the Los Angeles Ethnic Commission unanimously voted in favor of recommending that the City Council Rules, Elections, and Intergovernmental Relations Committee seriously consider using random drawings and cash prizes during elections. Commissioners said they were unsure about the amount of prizes and total cost, but Commissioner President Nathan Hochman offered $25,000 to $50,000 as an estimate. While federal law says it is illegal for people to accept payment for voting, the commission says the law would not apply as long as the federal positions are not on the ballot. According to the LA Times, only 23% of voters participated in the city's election last year, which is why the commission hopes to implement this policy as soon as 2015. Do you think cash prizes should be offered in exchange for voting?
Oh, okay, so I'm kind of like middle grounds here because like I know it's my duty as a citizen to go out and vote, but sometimes I just don't because I'd rather stand and watch Netflix, as bad as that sounds, I know. But if someone was telling me that I was getting a cash prize, yeah, I'd probably do it.
I mean, everyone loves money, so that's a perfect thing to use to get people out. And voting was less than 30%. That's horrible. So I think, exactly.
Yeah.
I think it's a win-win situation. You get people to go out and vote. You get a better representation.
Yeah.
And, I mean, people are getting money, so.
Woo-woo for that, yeah.
Okay, 30% is bad, but guys, there's absentee ballots. You know, there's countries around the world where women didn't have the right to vote.
That's true.
You know, we didn't even have the right in the United States till women's suffrage and the amendment. I think it's our right and our duty to vote in this country, and I think we should definitely do that. If you can't get out to the polls, you know, get the absentee one. It gets sent straight to your house.
Leave it to Jen to prove a point.
Yeah, right?
I know. Okay. Well, TMZ released a graphic video Monday showing Baltimore Ravens player Ray Rice punching his then-fiancée, Janae Palmer, in a hotel elevator. The video, which occurred in February, resulted in Rice's termination from the Baltimore Ravens and suspension from the NFL this week. However, the NFL is now facing backlash from critics after a former hotel employee said Tuesday that the organization saw the video at the time of the incident and still decided to enact minimal punishment against Rice. Since the assault, Rice's felony assault charges have been dropped in favor of supervised counseling. What do you think about Ray Rice's punishment then and now that the video has emerged?
I think this punishment should have happened when it first came out.
Yeah.
I mean, come on, why do we need a video to back it up? When it first came out that he knocked out his then fiance, that's enough to, I mean, have all of this happen.
Are they still together?
They're still, I mean, they're married now. They're married.
And she defended him in the court case. You know, she said that, you know, regardless of it, she's still with him, she still loves him. There was even a hashtag on Twitter, why I stayed. Yeah.
This punishment should have happened a long time ago. I mean, it's good. I think it's good that it's happening now. No one should have to deal with this kind of abuse.
Well, you were telling me what the NFL is
doing. Well, there's a lot of steps that are going on. He's already lost all of his sponsors.
Uh-huh.
The NFL, they're taking him out of the video game that they have, this Madden 15 game. They're taking him out. That just came out. Mm-hmm. He's being taken out
That's crazy.
The Ravens are offering an exchange for his jersey at any of their locations. And there's one more. And they're also his alma mater. This is it. His alma mater, they're taking down his picture on the banner. And they're also taking him out of their highlight reel that they play before the games.
But you know what? When you're doing something that, like, absurd, and for, like, it to not, well, it just makes me go crazy because I think that's, like, ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
I would not want to stay with somebody that's doing that. Like, he deserves all the punishment he's getting, all of the attention that he's getting. No man or woman should lay hands on their significant other, fiancé,
exactly.
Now husband, wife. Like, that's not appropriate, you know? So he deserves it, I think.
I agree.
And totally, you know, it should have happened back in February when the incident happened. You
Know,
you can't tell me the NFL couldn't get the video. Yeah. I mean, they're the NFL. If it took some guy who used to work at the hotel to go to TMZ to get it out there, I mean, I feel like that says something about our society. Like, don't penalize him when there's no video, but then when the video comes out, oh no, oh geez, we have to suspend him.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Ridiculous. Well, now let's switch over to the campus events of the week.
On Thursday, September 11th, the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute of Cal State Fullerton, or OLLI, is hosting a discussion on campus known as Big History, an open discussion about various topics by local experts. The discussion will be from 12:30 p.m. to 2 p.m., and it will be held at McKay Auditorium in the Rugby Gerontology Center. Jonathan Mackley will be the event's main speaker, as well as others experts from fields ranging from Big Bang cosmology, plate tectonics, and evolution. Admission for the event is free, and it is also open to the general public. So if you, a friend, or anyone you know are interested in attending this insightful event, come by and be part of this eclectic discussion about the world we live in.
All That Jazz is coming to Cal State Fullerton this Saturday, September 13th, for its annual Concert Under the Stars. The concert will feature all genres of jazz, from Latin to funk. Faculty members and Grammy Award-winning jazz pianist, composer, and arranger Bill Cunliffe will be the musical director for the night. The concert will feature students and alumni of the College of the Arts. For ticket information, visit fullerton.edu/concert.
ASI will be having their annual block party on Thursday, September 18th, an all-day event that will be divided in four different segments. Four at 8 a.m., there will be a small breakfast occurring in four different locations: the TSU patio, Central Quad, Nutwood parking structure near PA, and the East Side parking structure walkway, where coffee, tea, and assorted pastries will be offered. Next, at 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., will be the resource fair held at the TSU East patio and SRC walkway, where information on ASI, food, games, and giveaways, such as a chance to win a free parking pass for the spring semester, will be offered. Then at 4 p.m. is ASI's third annual Orange Fest, a four-hour concert in the Becker Amphitheater. More information on that will be coming soon. And finally, at 8 p.m. is a Throwback Thursday screening of the great film Jurassic Park, also at the Becker Amphitheater.
Our very own Titan TV reporter and former military chief, Chef Derek Phillips, is back with another step-by-step tutorial in our latest college cooking segment. Let's take a look.
Thank you, Jen. With football season upon us and the holiday season rapidly approaching, we are sometimes called upon to bring a covered dish. Or maybe you just want some easy comfort food. This doesn't have to be a challenge, even if you live in the dorms. Today I have a recipe that is fast, easy, big on flavor, and easy to clean up, all while not breaking the bank. It is called Warm and Creamy Bacon Dip. What you need is simple. You'll need a slow cooker. Ones like this one can be found starting around $10. They're relatively inexpensive. These are great because they're portable, you can throw stuff in before you leave for the day, and it's ready for you that night. And it's nearly impossible to burn your food in a slow cooker. Next, you're going to need 8 ounces of softened cream cheese. Now, that just means that you should pull it out of the fridge about a half hour before you begin to cook with it and let it warm up so that it's easier to work with. So we go ahead and get it right in there. Next, we're going to follow that with about 4 ounces of bacon bits. We happen to have some of these left over from our last show. For the chicken Caesar salad. So we're gonna throw those right in there. Now you could use real bacon. In fact, that would probably be a little bit better, but it's not necessary. We're also going to add 2 cups of sour cream. Whatever your favorite sour cream is just fine. And you'll get that put right in there. Use a nice rubber spatula to get everything out of the container. Up next is 2 cups of nice shredded cheddar cheese. That's gonna be about half of this package here. We'll get that in there nice and cheesy. And finally, we'll garnish with a cup of chopped green onion. That's gonna give it a nice visual appeal. Plus, it's gonna taste great. Now, what we're gonna do next is just basically fold everything together, And once we get everything folded together, we're gonna turn the slow cooker on low and we're gonna let it sit. And remember, when you turn the slow cooker on and you put your lid on it, leave that lid on for at least 90 minutes. If you keep taking the lid off, you're gonna lose all of the goodness that you've got built up in there. That's kind of the point of a slow cooker. There, make sure you put it on low. And like I said, leave it for about 90 minutes. Now this dirt dip can be served with some nice wholesome veggies or in a bread bowl, or my favorite way, just alongside a bowl of your nice favorite chips. Slow cooker recipes are very easy to find online. You can look at the manufacturer's website of your particular slow cooker. You can search websites like allrecipes.com, or most food manufacturers have recipe for their products, like our sour cream here, which is where our recipe came from today. My favorite source for recipes, however, happens to be just my family. Most of us have a favorite aunt or grandmother that has a library of recipes. Calling one of them gives a new recipe to me, and it really enhances their day. Now that you have a warm, creamy bacon dip added to your repertoire and a slow cooker to your kitchen, you can begin to experiment with different dishes. Thank you for joining me. I am Derek Phillips. Remember, flavor is fortunate if it is bold.
And now we'll switch over to some updates in local news. California's current Democratic Governor Jerry Brown faced off against his Republican challenger Neil Kashkari in a heated debate on California politics last week. Topics covered during the event varied from schools, jobs, transportation, energy, water, and crime. According to the LA Times, the latest polls have Brown leading against Kashkari 50% to 34%. The debate was aired on local radio and television stations, but due to NBC's simultaneous broadcast of the football season opener game between the Green Bay Packers and Seattle Seahawks, ratings for the debate were lower than expected.
A plane flying from Fullerton Municipal Airport to Chino was forced to land in a Brea landfill on Monday due to engine failure. The two people aboard the 1975 Beechcraft Bonanza A36 were unharmed. The 70-year-old pilot Fred Geller told the Orange County Register that he has over 45 years of flight experience, which is said to have contributed to the plane's safe landing. Deputy Director of Landfill Operations for the county, Kevin Condrew, said a similar issue occurred in 2005 when another plane experienced mechanical problems and landed in the same area.
Six Flags Magic Mountain's iconic Colossus roller coaster caught fire Monday, destroying one of the wooden coaster's tallest peaks, and it took the Los Angeles County firefighters 30 minutes to extinguish the 1,000 square foot fire, according to the Orange County Register. Officials said the blaze was triggered by construction being performed on the ride, which is currently undergoing a remodel. The theme park announced plans earlier this month to transform the 36-year-old ride into a hybrid wood and steel coaster with greater speeds and more extreme drops. The park was closed at the time the fire occurred and no injuries were reported.
And now we'll take a look at some of the latest news here in the U.S. and abroad. The iPhone 6 is finally here, but for the first time in years, this device was not the star of Apple's convention in Cupertino on Tuesday. In addition to the new iPhone 6 and iPhone 6 Plus, which allow consumers the option to choose between 4.7 and 5.5-inch screen sizes, the company also revealed its new Apple Watch. The latest gadget incorporates technological advances, including video, messaging, health monitoring, and GPS. The watch will also be able to connect with third-party apps that could allow users to open hotel room doors without a key card or pay without a wallet. The company also unveiled a new technology called Apple Pay, designed to transform the iPhone into a digital wallet.
Iraq's parliament concluded its deliberation on Monday, naming Haider al-Abadi the country's new prime minister. Iraqi lawmakers also approved nearly all of the proposed candidates for the prime minister's cabinet, excluding a few key positions. The decision to replace lawmakers in parliament was backed by countries that have advocated for a more representative government to ease tensions among groups that felt unrepresented and to combat extremist aggression in the country and nearby Syria. The newly selected prime minister told parliament he would support military operations confronting extremists, potentially including those conducted by the U.S.
Tributes and fond memories were delivered in true Hollywood fashion in honor of the late comedian Joan Rivers at her funeral on Sunday. Family, friends, and celebrities from theater, fashion, and media gathered at the Fifth Avenue Synagogue in New York to pay their respects. Mourners included fellow comedians Whoopi Goldberg and Rosie O'Donnell, fashion designers Michael Kors and Carolina Herrera, and TV reporters Barbara Walters, Diane Sawyer, and Geraldo Rivera. In her 2012 book, I Hate Everyone, Starting With Me, Rivers made it clear she didn't want an average funeral. Rivers said instead of a rabbi, she wanted Meryl Streep crying in five different accents. The comedian's death is currently under investigation. Rivers was hospitalized in August after she went into cardiac arrest during a routine procedure.
The Duke and Duchess of Cambridge have made international headlines once again. The royal family issued a statement Monday that Prince William and Duchess Catherine are expecting their second child. The Duchess was treated for severe morning sickness earlier on Monday, according to the Associated Press. Officials at Clarence House, the royal couple's office, said both of their families are delighted with the baby news. After 13-month-old Prince George, the new boy, or girl, is expected to become fourth in line to the throne, followed by Prince Harry in fifth.
Well, that's all we have for this edition of The Report. Join us next time for the latest news, views, and info to go. I'm Christina Rasband.
I'm Sarah Fenton.
And I'm Jen Moynihan. Stay fresh, Fullerton.